this video, we're going to continue looking at covering spaces, and I want to explain the idea of monodromy, which is basically what makes covering spaces such a powerful tool for studying a fundamental group. And in order to make sense of monodromy, we're going to need to look at this thing called path lifting. So what is monodromy? Well, let's take an example of a covering space we've already seen. This may be the 3-to-1 cover of the circle by the circle. This is the map. If you think of this as the circle inside the complex numbers, the unit circle, this is the map P3 of z equals z cubed. So each point downstairs has 3 pre-images. What is monodromy? Well, monodromy means looking at what happens to those 3 points as you go round the loop in the base. So let's this point here is 1 in the unit circle. So let's say we're looking at what happens to P3 inverse of 1, which is these 3 points. I'll color them in red. They're living over 1. So let me call them A, B, and C, right? One of them is 1, one e to the I, 2 pi over 3, whatever. Let me just call them A, B, and C. This is the set ABC. As we go around the loop in the base, so what does happen? Well, as I move around in the base, you can see A moves around a path and ends up at B. B moves around a path and ends up at C, and C moves around a path and ends up at A. So A goes to B, goes to C, which goes back to A. So we get a cyclic permutation. If we go around twice, A goes around to B and then on to C, B goes around to C and then on to A, and etc. So, you know, iterating the loop in the base means iterating the cyclic permutation. So what we really get is a homomorphism from pi 1 of the base x, this is called x and this is called y, to the group of permutations of the fiber. So in general, this is going to be called P, not necessarily P3. So let's say P inverse of the base point x. Now in our particular case, this is pi 1 of the circle, whatever that group is, mapping to the permutations of this 3-element set. Is the symmetric group on 3 elements, and we know that this element that goes around this loop maps to a cyclic permutation of order 3. So this loop maps to the 3 cycle A, B, C. In particular, this is a non-trivial element of this group. That means this has to be a non-trivial element of pi 1 s 1. So that's how we're going to prove that pi 1 s1 is non-trivial, right? By writing down some covering space. And so this allows us to detect non-trivial elements of the fundamental group. So that's basically the thing we didn't already know how to do. So monodromy is an action of pi 1 of x on the fiber, base point. Or I should say this is the pi 1 of x base to x. On the fiber over x. Because, so group actions and homomorphisms to permutation groups, they're the same thing. So this is another way of saying what I've said here, that you get a homomorphism from pi 1 of x to the permutation group. And it gives a way to detect non-trivial elements in the fundamental group if they act non-trivially. Point is, there's always going to be some covering space in which a non-trivial element of the fundamental group is going to act non-trivially, a so-called universal cover. So that allows you to completely detect the fundamental group. Right, so this was a pretty vague explanation because I didn't justify really what it meant for A to go around this path from A to B. So that's going to be justified by this idea of path lifting, and I didn't justify that we get a well-defined homomorphism from pi 1 of x to this permutation group, and that's going to be fixed by something called homotopy lifting. So as a first step, I need to state what's called the path lifting lemma. So maybe I'll make a new page. Which is going to allow us to define what it means for A, B, and C to move around paths in the total space. So here's the lemma. Suppose P from Y to X is a covering map . Let delta be a path starting point delta of 0 called x, and let y be some point in P inverse of x. So back to this example, maybe we start off with x equals 1 and y is going to be one of these three points A, B or C. Delta is going to be the loop that goes around the circle exactly once. So then there exists a unique path, gamma, in Y, in the covering space, which lifts delta, i.e. that means if you project gamma, then you get a map from 0, 1 to y, and then from y to x. So that's a path in x, and we want that to be equal to delta. Such that gamma of 0 is the chosen initial condition y. So again, returning to our example, if delta is this loop here, gamma would be, well, if we start with A as our initial condition, it would be this path here. If we started with B as our initial condition, it would be this path here. And if we started with C as our initial condition, it would be this path here. So I said unique lift, right? But I've drawn three different gammas. Well, the uniqueness means you specify a base point A for the lift to start at, an initial condition, and then it's unique. So there may be three lifts, but there's only one for each initial condition. Okay, so that's what path lifting says. So let's move on to the proof. I somehow need to use the fact that this is a covering map, because this is not going to be true in general. So let curly U be a collection of elementary neighborhoods. Covering the whole of X. Remember, elementary neighborhoods are the subsets of X on which the local inverses for the covering map are defined, and being a covering space means every point of X is contained in at least one elementary neighborhood. So just take all of them. Then, if I look at delta inverse U for U in this curly U. This is an open cover in the sense of the Heine-Borel theorem compactness of the interval 0, 1. Again, this word cover is not covering space, this just means the open sets cover the whole of 0, 1. Okay, by compactness of the interval, we can find a finite subcover and in particular we can subdivide the interval into subintervals between t0, which is 0, t1, t2, etc., to tn, which is 1, such that if I call delta k the restriction of delta to the subinterval between k tk and tk plus 1, then this path lands in uk, one of these elementary sets, elementary neighborhoods. Okay, so we can get away with just taking a finite set of elementary neighborhoods and a finite set of times, and each segment of the path is going to land in exactly one elementary neighborhood. So we're going to construct gamma by induction on K. So first of all, let's define it between t0 and t1. Well, we know by hypothesis that gamma is supposed to send 0 to y. And if you remember what it means to be an elementary neighborhood, it means that, so this is U0, there's a bunch of elementary sheets living over U0 which are indexed by some discrete set F. Y is going to be living in one of these sheets, and we have these local inverses QM where each M parameterizes one of the sheets, so one of them is going to land in this sheet. Let me just call it Q. So because P is a covering map, there exists a local inverse Q defined on U0 going to Y such that Q of X equals Y. So I'm going to just define gamma to be equal to Q composed delta 0. Let's say gamma 0 to be Q composed delta 0 on the interval between t0 and t1. So between 0 and t1. Okay, and then, so that I've now achieved construction of the lift between T0 and T1. I want it now constructed between T1 and T2, and then continue. So let's suppose I've actually constructed it all the way up to TK. Just told you how to construct it when k is equal to 1. I'm going to then construct it on tk to tk plus 1. What am I going to do? Well, I'm going to say there exists another q. Let me call it q. Let's call this one Q0, and this one's called QK, from UK to Y, such that QK of delta of TK, in other words, the path of this point, goes up to gamma of TK. And that makes sense. I've already defined gamma as far as TK, so this is a well-defined point. And if I want my path to be continuous, it has to pick up at TK where it left off at TK. So then we just define gamma K to be QK composed delta K. And that extends gamma to the interval between tk and tk plus 1. So then we just use gamma equals gamma k on the interval tk to tk plus 1. And this is continuous because each QK is continuous and delta K is continuous. So gamma K is continuous. And each gamma K, gamma K plus 1 agree where they're both defined on the overlap. The overlap is just the point TK plus 1. So if you have continuous maps on closed subsets that agree on the overlaps, they glue together to give you a continuous map everywhere. So this gives us the existence of a lift, gamma. And you can check this is a lift because P composed gamma on the subinterval gamma k is just p composed qk composed delta k. And qk is an inverse for p, local inverse, so this composition is the identity. This is just delta k. Oh, I should say this is gamma k. So this tells us that gamma k lifts delta k. What I haven't yet proved is this part of the path lifting lemma, namely the uniqueness of the lift. And the proof of that, I'm going to state it as a lemma, which is slightly more general and which will be really useful later in the course. And actually, the proof is quite long. The video I've made is already quite long, so I'm going to defer that to the next video.